Are you rational? We take a lot of things for granted. There are 24 hours in a day. If you slam the gas pedal, the car will go. We're rational, and if we were irrational, we would know it. Unfortunately, that last one is not true due to cognitive biases. Cognitive biases are errors in our reasoning. Everyone has them, but we don't realize it unless we're open to letting someone else point them out in us. You probably think you're exceptionally rational. In fact, you might say that you're more rational than the average person. Well, that phenomenon in and of itself is called the bias blind spot. It's a lot like colorblindness. If you grew up colorblind, you probably wouldn't even realize it because it formed such a definitive part of how you experienced life. Your only clue would be watching how someone else experiences life or going to an optometrist. It's exactly the same with cognitive biases. Because we all grow up with them and we all learn them from our friends and family, we don't even realize how it affects our reasoning. In becoming a nomadic landscape photographer, I've personally had to confront many of my own biases as they were holding me back in my own field. By learning to recognize these cognitive biases in your own travel and in your own photography, you'll be better equipped to conquer them in your day-to-day so that way you can advance in your field faster. The first cognitive bias is the sunk cost fallacy, which I like to sum up in the phrase, I'll just make the best of it. The sunk cost fallacy is when a decision, often a purchase, turns out to be a loss, either of time, money, or effort. But you're reluctant to abandon the decision because it feels like you need to recoup your loss, perhaps by spending just a little bit more time. For example, let's say that you purchased a bus ticket to a photography location, but after doing a little bit more research, you find that this location isn't going to be that great. Unfortunately, your ticket was non-refundable. You might be tempted to follow through because you've already purchased the ticket. You should just go ahead and go there and make the most of it. But what you're actually doing is you're just adding to your loss. If you had swallowed your initial loss, which was that non-refundable bus ticket, yeah, there's nothing you can do about that. Thus, it should not affect your reasoning right now. By going to the location anyway, which you know is not going to be that great, you're actually postponing other places that you could be going. You could probably find a better place to photograph and spend your time and money there instead of continuing to sink more effort, more time, and more money into this poor decision. During a shoot, I have to challenge this cognitive bias all the time. I'll often make a very long drive out to a photography location. I'll pull up and realize, you know what? This is not really a great spot. This is probably going to be a bust. And because I made such a long drive, it feels like such a waste to turn around and maybe move on to the next spot because I just spent like an hour or two getting out there. But really, if I go out and shoot what I know is going to be a failure, I'm continuing to waste more time, more money, more effort in this location when I could have moved on to the next. So the fallacy is letting a cost that you can't recoup continue to affect your decision. You have to recognize that the loss is sunk, meaning there's no way you can recoup it, and thus it should have no influence on what your next choice is, whether you choose to go through or whether you choose to go a different path altogether. The second fallacy is the planning fallacy, which I like to sum up as, I'll improve with time. It's founded on the assumption that investing more time in your photography will necessarily produce better results. However, your goal really should be to maximize the amount of learning you get for as little time and as little effort as possible. Or in other words, instead of asking, how can I get more time to learn? We want to ask, how can I learn more from my time? And that starts with identifying our tendency to forget prior experiences. So think back to your last trip and ask yourself, how many waypoints did you have to find ahead of time to get a particular keeper ratio? What time did you actually have to get up to make a dawn shoot? How many clothes did you actually wear? Did you take notes on any of this? Probably not. Unfortunately, that means you're not even taking that into consideration when you go to plan your next trip. You won't know about these failures unless you write it down. So I recommend keeping a journal and filling it out several times a day. If you think you're above journaling or writing anything down, you're actually falling prey to the planning fallacy and allowing yourself to repeat history yet again. So don't fall into that. Swallow your pride. Start journaling. I recommend doing it several times a day. Just find an app on your phone that you like, or maybe go old school. Grab a Moleskine notebook and write down notes on your trip. Everything seems concrete until we articulate it. So make a point of journaling these things. And then when you get ready to plan for your next trip, pull out the notes and start analyzing them and ask yourself, what went wrong? Why did it go wrong? And what am I going to change next time to keep this from happening? In a nutshell, that's what a retrospective is. Looking back at prior data, analyzing it, and figuring out what you're going to tweak to prevent it. If you don't plan for success, you're planning for failure. So don't fall into the planning fallacy. The third cognitive bias is survivorship bias. We covered this in a previous vlog, which I've linked to in the description. It can be summed up in the phrase, well, I should imitate what successful photographers have done. There are fabulous photographers out there to learn from, but the best ones, you've probably never even heard of. That's survivorship bias in a nutshell. We assume that we should follow in the footsteps of these other successful photographers, and we forget that these successful photographers are really just synonymous with photographers that we could find in the first place, probably through online media, maybe YouTube or their educational resources or their blog. So because these photographers are so prolific online, we discover them in the first place, and so we assume that we need to follow every step they take to recreate their success. But what we're really doing is associating success with visibility. That, in a nutshell, is your survivorship bias, or more generally, the selection bias. As an educator myself, I fall into this category of folks who are trying to promote their channel, their YouTube material, their educational content, which means there are folks 10 times better who we may never hear from, who you may never even discover and know to imitate their success. Really, what you get from imitating the folks that you know is you're probably going to learn to imitate their marketing strategies, which, while beneficial, doesn't necessarily correlate with successful photography. Now, I'm not saying you should go unsubscribe from all of the educational content you follow. Please don't. And if you haven't yet, please hit the subscribe button. But what it means is that you should focus less on the success stories and less on a photographer's successes, and instead go look for posts about failures, ways in which these photographers have missed something and what they did to change that. So given two posts, one called 10 Mistakes I Made on My Last Shoot versus 10 Ways to Create Killer Landscape Photos, the first one is going to give you much better learning material. In fact, in survivorship bias, you might say that the second post, How to Create 10 Killer Landscape Shots, actually gives you zero information because it gives you the success without showing you the steps to get there. Those can only be learned from failure. As an educator, I've watched survivorship bias cripple my students' ability to learn. They assume that looking at a working solution and trying to analyze why it works gives you more to work with than analyzing their own broken solution and trying to get that working, when in fact it's the reverse. Analyzing a working solution, even from a mathematical perspective, gives you zero new information. But looking at a close to working but not quite working solution and spending the time to get it working is where learning actually happens, whether it be in software development or in photography. To really beat survivorship bias, you need to stop focusing on what works and instead focus on what didn't work, why didn't it work, and what will you change for next time to prevent that issue from happening again. Cognitive biases are everywhere. We all have them. There's no escaping them, but you can be aware of them. That way they will have less control over you. I've personally found that identifying these at work has helped me be up to 50% more productive with my time. And in my landscape photography, I've been able to take shorter trips and yet get more out of them. So how would you like that? To learn more while spending less time. So that way, every spare moment you get, you'll just get that much more from your learnings. That's the benefit of recognizing these cognitive biases. They will cease to affect your reasoning as much as the average person. Now, there's a few other cognitive biases we didn't get a chance to get to today, so I'll do that in a follow-up vlog. So to make sure that you get up-to-date news on those new vlogs, make sure to subscribe to the channel for the latest digital nomad tips, landscape photography tutorials, and on-location vlogs.